let's sing this song. Ah.
Got a story to tell you.
Yeah.
Some things that I've been through, but I'm here.
Yo, I'm here.
Good morning. We welcome all our visitors, the members of the Town and Country Seventh-day Adventist Church, and the members of the Bethlehem Seventh-day Adventist Church. Today, we are welcome each and every one, visitors, to our Zoom as we are back in church this morning. Welcome, 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 and may the Lord bless us this day. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for bringing us here this morning. Lord, as we are about to go into your word, open our minds. And Lord, help us to understand what's in your holy word this morning. Bless us as we study your word, dear Father, and give us the insight as to what we're going to be doing in Sabbath school this morning, especially your lesson to us. Bless us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I will introduce our presenter, Mr. Darrell Merton. Thank you.
All right. So, restless and rebellious. Now, let's keep in mind that society teaches us not to rest until we have what we want. It tells us not to rest until we have money, not to rest until we have good cars, not to rest until what? For what? We keep chasing after material things and we do not have rest until we physically die. So it is important to understand that there is no peace in this world because we often become rebellious because we are restless. And this division happens in the church because many of us are restless and we have nothing to do, we become rebellious. So we want to chase after many things, material things, chase after position, chase after many things of this life, and we have no true peace. So what does the book of Matthew chapter 11 verse 29 says? It says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Okay, so let us also look at the book of Luke chapter 12 verse 7. It says, "Indeed, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Don't be afraid, you are worth more than many sparrows." So are you restless? Because we want to realize that Christ wants to give you peace in your heart. He wants to give you rest. Do you remember the Samaritan woman at the well? She's been with six men. She had no rest. But when she met the seventh man, Christ, she had rest in her heart. So I am inviting you to find rest in Christ today. No material thing, no tangible item, no person can fill the void in your heart but Christ. So let us look at Jesus. The memory text for today is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11. It says, "Now all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages have come." So let's look in context. What is being talked about here? We are talking about the Israelites, because we know that the Israelites, they were in the wilderness, yet they did not have any rest. Did they believe in God? Did they hold on to his promise? I think not. They were always looking at themselves and they were always stressed because they did not look at the person who gave them rest. So we want to ask ourselves, are we the same way today? Because we could be going through spiritual wilderness. We could be going through wilderness of our lives. But are we holding on to God's promise? And do we believe in him? Do we believe that he has everything under control, that he is numbering every hair on our heads? That's a question for us to reflect on. All right, so let's look at Sunday's lesson, Restless in the Wilderness. All right, so let's recap here. This world teaches us that we should identify ourselves with what we have. We identify ourselves with the house that we live in or the apartment that we live in. We identify ourselves with the type of car that we drive. We identify ourselves with the clothes that we wear. You know, this is what this world is teaching us. It's not teaching us to identify ourselves with our creator, with God. It's teaching us to identify ourselves with created things. So it is important to realize that we want to keep looking at the author and finisher of our faith. We want to keep looking at Jesus. How were the Israelites? When we look at the Israelites, we understand that they left Egypt physically, but not spiritually. Remember earlier we talked about how the world teaches us to take tangible items and identify ourselves with it? Well, they identified themselves, all right, with created things. They identified themselves with Egyptian food. They identified themselves with the way they worship in Egypt. They didn't identify themselves with God. We can see this very closely because when we look at the Israelites, God gave them manna from heaven. When we look closely, they were not content with what God gave. They were asking for food from Egypt. They kept having Egypt in their minds. Egypt, Egypt, Egypt. They carried Egypt along with them. They didn't look to God. They were not content with God. They looked at their situation, the circumstances in their lives, and then they thought, man, look at what we have. We have nothing here. We are in the wilderness. What do we have? Nothing but this bread. I wish we had the food from Egypt. So this is a lesson for us. You know, the wilderness is actually a good thing because we know that we identify ourselves with God. We identify ourselves with the provider. We don't identify ourselves with what we have. Yes, you are blessed with what you have. If you have a good house, you're blessed. Okay, good. If you have a good car that takes you around, that's good. It's a blessing. But you don't identify yourselves with it. You identify yourselves with God. So are we trading in the spiritual bread for worldly bread? Are we like the Israelites who wanted to trade in manna for Egyptian food? Do we want to use the world ways instead of the word's ways? That's a question for us to keep in mind. Okay. So let us look at Monday's lesson. It's contagious. So let's summarize here. We know that if we identify ourselves with what we have, the money, the clothes we wear, the cars, everything, then it's going to cause division, especially in the church. If we take these worldly principles in the church, it's going to cause a lot of division. You know, we're going to be looking at other members of the church, looking to see what kind of car they drive, what kind of suit they're wearing. Oh, he's wearing a different suit today. He's driving in with a different car today. He is, this person lives in a nice house. You know, we start looking at what we have. We start coveting one another. We start lusting after what we have. We start lusting after people's cars, people's clothes, and it doesn't bring peace in the church. Now, Christ said to love one another. He did not say to lust one another. Satan says lust one another. Christ says love one another. So let's remember, if Christ is not in our focus, then we have division. Christ is the head. A headless body is a dead body. A church without Christ is dead. Now, when we look at Aaron, Miriam, and Moses, we understand that there was a problem. Now, what was the problem? Now, we understand the fact that they became very jealous of Moses. And they ask, who put him in authority over us? You see, let's make something clear. Aaron and Miriam, they looked at themselves. They did not look at others. They did not look at God. They looked at themselves. The same spirit that was causing division in heaven was taking place in the book of Numbers, chapter 12, verse 1 to 3. Because we can see that Miriam and Aaron, they were motivated by the spirit of Satan, because they had jealousy over Moses. So what happened here? We know that God rebuked Aaron and Miriam. How? Well, we know that Miriam, she became a leper. And, you know, in the Bible, leprosy is very symbolic for sin, Because if you were a leper, you had to be, you had to go out from among the people. You had to be basically cut off if you were a leper. So leprosy represents sin, because if you hold on to a lifestyle of sin and you choose not to repent, you are cut off from God's people. So how is this important for us today? How is this important for us today? Well, we understand that in the church, we can be prone to be jealous of another person because we can see that, oh, this person preaches well, or this person teaches well. And we can be criticizing that person in every little thing when God has instructed that person to preach the gospel or teach the gospel, or by whatever gift they have to show the gospel, we could be tempted to be jealous of that person, have that same satanic spirit. So it is important to understand that if we hold on to that spirit, it makes us even more spiritually sick. And holding that in our hearts will sooner or later cause division in the church. So it is important to understand that we must keep looking at God. We must be selfless. And whatever gift you have, bring it to the table. Do not covet another person's gift. If you teach, then teach for the glory of God. If you preach, preach for the glory of God. If you are a greeter for the glory of God, then greet for the glory of God. But don't look at others and become jealous and think of self. So very important to understand. All right, so let's look at Tuesday's lessons. Restlessness leads to rebellion. Okay, so what if we mix worldly principles with God's word? I can assure you that that would not work. Remember, when we look at the Israelites, they were made as an example for us. So what can we take to perspective? We understand that the Israelites, they did not truly understand God's way. They did not truly understand God. They did not spend time with God, because the promises that God had, they did not hold on to it, because they did not believe. They kept thinking, oh, how can we get through this? They were thinking of themselves. The Israelites were thinking of themselves. They were thinking, how can we get through this? How can we overtake these people? The land that God promised us, yes, it is so beautiful. It is promising, but the people there, they are so big. We can't go against them. We are so small. We're gonna die. We're gonna be killed. God promised them that the land is theirs. And God said, hey, look, I'm the one giving you this land. It's not you doing it, it's me. I'm not expecting you to go through this alone. I'm the one carrying you through this. But yet the Israelites identify themselves as grasshoppers rather than soldiers of God. You know, a lot of times we are the same way today. Let me ask you this question. If you know you were going through a dangerous area, okay, and you had security guards, would you feel more relief? Would you feel safe? Yes, you would. You would feel safe rather than going alone through a dangerous area. How much more for God, though? You know, we are in the wilderness. We are in a world that is corrupt. We are in a world that is not godly. But God promises he's going to be with us every step of the way. But are we disbelieving in him? You know, a lot of times we put more trust in people than God himself. You know, furthermore, what's interesting, the Israelites, they ask for a leader that would take them back to Egypt. They became upset because they were like, man, we cannot overtake these people. What are we gonna do? Listen, we shouldn't have come over here in the first place. We should not come down in the wilderness in the first place. We need to go back. We need a leader who would take us back to Egypt. Do we have the same thing happening today? Let me ask you a question. Now, isn't it interesting that Moses was leading them to the promised land, yet they wanted to create a counterfeit leader who would take them back to slavery, take them back to Egypt. Now, who does Moses represent? Moses points to Christ, because as Moses interceded for the people, as we're going to see in this next lesson, Christ represents us in heaven. Christ is our high priest. Do we have a high priest today? Do we have a system, a priestly system today that takes us back to spiritual Egypt? Is there a leader today that is saying, oh, you don't have to rely on the word of God. You could have marriage any way you want. You can keep the Sabbath any way you want. You can have a priestly service the way that you want. Do we have a system like this? I'm going to let you reflect. So it is important to realize that those who don't take the opportunity to know the God of love, they will rebel against him. They will rebel. If you don't know the love of God, there's nothing for you to do but be restless and rebellious, because Jesus gives you true peace. All right, so let's go to Wednesday's lessons and intercessor. Okay. So it is important to realize that sometimes we are unfaithful, but our intercessor is always faithful. The book of Hebrews chapter 4 verse 15 says what? It says, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet without sin. So let us realize something. Here, I want you to realize that, as we said earlier, Moses points to Christ. Now, what did Moses think about the rebellious Israelites? If we look at the book of Numbers, there was a time when God said, step aside, Moses, I'm going to take care of these people, and I'm going to make a new nation out of you. But how did Moses react? I want you to keep in mind here, Moses was not thinking of himself. He was so humble and he was so selfless. He was thinking about the people. I believe God was testing Moses here, because Moses really showed a Christ-like character. He portrayed a Christ-like character because he stood for the people. He was like, no, God, please, I want to keep interceding for these people. Please have mercy on these people. Moses was pleading for these people. The very people who were very rebellious and who were criticizing him. So this really shows a Christ-like character, because sometimes, you know, when we are rebellious, does Christ throw the towel and say, oh, I'm not dealing with this person anymore. I'm not dealing with these people anymore. Does Christ say that? No, Christ is willing. He's there with open arms for you. What does the book of Hebrews chapter 3 verse 1 to 6 says? It says, therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Christ Jesus, who was faithful to him who appointed him, as Moses also was faithful in his house. For this one has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who built the house has more honor than the house. For every house is built by someone, but he who built all things is God. And Moses indeed was faithful in all his house as a servant, for a testimony of those things which would be spoken afterward. But Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and rejoicing of the hope, firm to the end. Amen. So we see here that Christ is even better than Moses. Moses points to Christ. And Christ is willing to receive you in his arms and to keep changing you, to keep sanctifying you into beauty, into perfection, all in his love. All right, let us look forward to the last lesson for today, faith versus presumption. Very important topic. It is important for us to realize, friends, that both Israel and the church is led by God. But we could be in danger. Today, we could be in danger of being like the physical Israelites. We can be in danger when we are holding on to temporary things. We are holding on to worldly things. So it really shows that we don't want to do things out of presumption. We want to do things out of faith. Presumption is going outside of God's word to fulfill God's way outside of God's word, saying, oh, yeah, you could live a lifestyle of sin and still be saved. You can have idols and still be saved. You can be attached to all the material things you have and still be saved. The Bible doesn't teach that. Christ and Christ alone. It's not an issue to have a good car or a good house or lots of money. But if you put your heart in these things, instead of looking at Christ, having all of your heart devoted to Christ, then you're not going to be saved in that way. That's presumption. It's not salvation. That's presumption. It's not faith. So let's think, just like, for example, getting ready for a test. If you know all of the things that are going to be in the test, you're ready. You have assurance that you will pass the test because you know everything in that test. You know everything that's going to be in that, all the questions that are going to be there. You know all the answers because you've been studying all of this time. You won't be caught by surprise. So how much more when you read your Bible? How much more when you're spending time with God? If you really know God, you really know his character, you really know his love, you trust him. You know he's going to carry you through the wilderness. You know he's going to be there with you every step of the way. You claim his promises and you're letting God work in you. You're not doing things in your own power. So let us remember, friends, to focus on the right path. Look at Jesus, not to self. Look at Christ. For he says in the book of John, chapter 14, verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So I'm very glad that you guys have decided to join this Sabbath school Bible study. Let us remember, let us keep encouraging each other not to look at the things of this world, not to focus on the things of this world, but to focus on Christ. For he is the head of the church, he is the head of our lives, and we want to always keep being in him. Thank you. Let us pray together. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much for this wonderful time that we've had, this Sabbath school lesson. Lord, we want to be encouraged to look to you, the author and finisher of our faith. Help us to give you the glory and the praise every step of the way. Let us keep falling in love with you, Lord, because that's what it's all about, falling in love with you. Putting you first, you are the source of our life. And we want you to be in our hearts continually. And we thank you so much for being with us today. We ask for a special blessing in today's service, and thank you so much for being with us and for being faithful. Glory be to your name, dear Heavenly Father. In the name of Christ, we pray. Send us your spirit always. Amen.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his court with praise. God is good. God is love, and his goodness endureth forever. Let us praise God with all our hearts. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to serve you this morning. Lord, bless us as we are here in your sanctuary on this Sabbath day. Be with us and help us to understand that what we are seeing today could not happen if you did not allow it to happen. So Lord, keep us strong and give us more grace and more faith to go through this crisis, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Now I want to once again I want to welcome all our visitors on Zoom. And I want to welcome the members of the Town and Country and the Bethlehem Seventh-day Adventist Church. As we are about to start our divine service, we hope that you listen to what God is telling us today. Welcome, 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 and enjoy the day that God has prepared for us. I thank you.
Just lost.
Jesus gave instructions as to how the gospel would be carried through the world. He gave us an order, first of all, to go, ye therefore teach, preach, baptize in the name of Jesus. And then he gave us the way, the method to do it. And that was through tithes and offering. And this is what we use to spread the gospel throughout the world. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for giving us the good news and also giving us a way where we can contribute towards spreading the good news throughout the world. Lord, continue to bless us in this effort as we move forward in spreading your holy gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, the church has three ways in which we could give our tithes and offering. The first one is the online giving. The second one is through the U.S. mail. And the third method is, for those who are here, the offering plates to my right at the back of the church. When you're going out, you could deposit your tithes and offering in that plate. Thank you so much, and may God bless us as we continue to worship him. Now it's time for our intercessory prayer. If there's ever a time that we need prayer, it's now. As we see everything that's going on around us, God has so far protected us from the ravaging disease that's spreading all over this globe. The last I heard, over 4 million dead. So we have something to thank God for, that we are still here, we can still function, and God is good. Does Jesus care? Yes, he cares. When we are hurting, he cares. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much because you care. But in spite of what we are going through, Lord, you have afforded us the things we need to sustain our life. So, Lord, we are asking you to increase our faith in you, so that we'll be able to withstand what we see going on around us. Lord, help us not to be confused. Lord, we pray for the sick among us this morning. We know there are so many of us suffering. We pray for those who are financially strapped. Lord, we know on the 31st of this month, thousands of people are going to be homeless in this country as I speak. So, Lord, continue to open a way. Show them that you are in charge. Teach us your ways, Lord. And, Lord, help us to depend on you. Lord, we can't help ourselves in this situation. But, Lord, yes, the needs are so great among us, Lord. So, Lord, intervene on the behalf of your race, the human race. Lord, bless us at Bethlehem and town and country as we continue to do the work that you have given us to do. Lord, help us not to falter, Lord. Help us not to be missing in action, because you need us to continue the work which we have started. So, Lord, continue to bless us. Continue to take this thing seriously. And Lord, at the end of it all, we could say our work has been done. Again, Lord, bless us, keep us, we pray. In Jesus' name and for his sake.
Wonderful, merciful Savior. these last 13 months, we have been worshiping from our home. COVID-19 came in and hit us hard. But praise God, no one from our congregation lost their lives. Even though we had family members who we lost in different parts of this country and different parts of this world, we give God thanks for this opportunity to worship Him again in His sanctuary. And we pray that God will abide with us as we worship Him today. My wife, Dr. Grace Levy Clark, has a statement that she would like to make to encourage us as we move forward. Dr. Clark.
Good morning, everyone. We're happy for those who are with us on our virtual platforms, and we're thankful for those who are here with us in the sanctuary. My message to you today is to remember that what we need to do to protect ourselves is to get vaccinated. We are our brother's keeper. And remember, we're only as strong as our weakest link. We thank you so much for caring for each other. And we pray for you that today will be a blessed and happy day. Amen.
Thank you, Elder Alistair, for attempting to assist, forgetting that we do not touch. That's all right. That's all right. Praise the Lord. We are in the presence of the Lord. And in this day, we are going to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. I am reminded of the passage that says, where two or three are gathered in His name, His presence is there. We have more than two and three in the house of the Lord today. We are going to glorify Him. Our scripture for today, join with me, please, in your smartphone or in your Bible or whatever way means you can find the scripture. Probably you have memorized it. If you have not, then join me as we read the word of the Lord, 1 Peter, the book, 1 Peter, chapter 1. What book did I say? 1 Peter, James Peter. After James, we have Peter. Yes, we have the book of Peter, Hebrews, James, 1 and 2 Peter. We are going to stop in 1 Peter and reading from verse 3. When you have time, you can go back up to verse 1, and read it. Matter of fact, I will be addressing the first 12 verses. But for right now, because of the sake of time, I shall read from verse 3, which says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which, according to His abundant mercy, hath begotten us again unto a lively hope." Mark that word, lively hope. "By the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith, unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptation, that the trials of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ." My sermon title today is Living Hope, or Heavenly Hope. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we now come to the time where we need you. We need you more than ever. And we ask that your Holy Spirit will be here with us. And as I speak, I ask that my words will be touched by your Spirit, and that your people will hear that which you want us to hear today. In Jesus' name, amen. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 and 2 is the nuts and bolts of the letter. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 and 2 is the nuts and bolts of the letter. From whom, to whom, and why? This is the salutation. I could talk about the form of the letter, but I'm not. Don't have time. Then Peter begins the body of the letter in verses 3 through 12 with a summary of the points to be made in the remainder of the discussion. Hence, this passage serves as an introduction to the entire letter. Peter begins with a triumphant doxology. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Circumstances cannot crush his confidence in Christ, talking about Peter. Neither should circumstances crush our confidence in Christ. The newness in Christ describes the reader's situation. And Peter now turns to address this point. The metaphors Peter used pile one upon another. Our situation is so new, only analogy can describe it. Our future is one so new for human beings that only a second birth. Do you understand what I'm saying this morning? Using the analogy of a second birth in the scripture can compare it with its new life and its new inheritance. Our future, as is put in the text, is so precious. Only gold, fine gold, can be compared to it. Though like gold, we will be tested by fire. What is happening to us today, the circumstances that we go through, the trials and temptations that we are faced with, we are being tempted. We are being tested. Pardon me. We are being tested. COVID-19 is a test. I believe it is a test. But we are being tried. Whatever test we go through, we are being tried in the fire. Your test may be the same as mine, but your test may also be different from mine. It is a test. And our future, so precious that only gold is being used here, that we can compare our future and our trials with. Our reaction to Christ must be so solid and joyful that only the importance, hear me somebody, only the importance of the outcome of history itself can begin to do it justice. Peter, in our text, refers to Christ four times in the first three verses. Did you notice that? Refers to Christ four times in the first three verses. Tells us the importance of Jesus Christ in our lives. His hope is not in religion, but in a person. His hope is not a dead clump of clay that will dissolve in the rains of persecution. It is a solid rock. As they say, solid as a rock. It is a solid rock that will stand secure even in the flood of persecution. Is your faith solid rock even in the face of persecution? Even in the flood of persecution? That is why Peter begins like a volcano as he erupts with a fiery flow of gratitude to God. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We can learn from Peter that if we begin with God and his grace, rather than with the gutter and our gripes, we can face even hellish persecution with heavenly praise. The secret, saints of God, the secret of a heavenly hope is to begin above the clouds, where you know the sun is shining. Then you can come down and face the problems of life. But if you begin with the problems, you get bogged down and never see above the clouds. You cannot rise above because of the weight of your trials. And hope begins to fade. You see, hope is like the mainspring of a watch. I don't know if they make, the watches that they make these days are not like the ones before. But hope is like the mainspring of the old-time watches. When it goes, when the mainspring goes, the watch ceases to fulfill its purpose. And if hope is lost, so is the purpose and meaning of life. You see, hope is a necessity and not a luxury. Hope is something important. It's not a luxury. We want to examine Peter's message in these opening verses to see what the reasons are for having such hope and what the results can be if we rely on those reasons. The reasons for our hope. In verses 2-3, Peter says, we, the children of God, are to be ready at all times. When, everybody? All times. At all times. To give a reason for our hope. Are you ready? If someone should ask you today to give a reason for your hope, would you be ready to give a reason for your hope? That's what Peter is saying here in verses 2 and 3, that we are to be ready at all times, not sometimes, but at all times to give reason for our hope. All of the reasons for our hope, for our having hope, are found in God and not in ourselves, not in our home, not in our cars, not in our jobs, not in our health. Our hope is founded in God himself. It is God's love that prompts, his grace that provides, and his power that perfects. The reason no great philosophy has satisfied the hearts of men is because they all begin with man and work up to God. But scripture begins with God and works down to man. Somebody need to say hallelujah. Yes, scripture begins with God and then works down to man. The only reason for having hope, Ella Small, the only reason for having hope, having any hope at all, can I put it that way, is because of the salvation plan of God. Ooh, somebody's quiet in the house today. Somebody needs to say hallelujah. Somebody needs to shout amen. Let me say it again, Ella Small. The only reason for having any hope at all is because of the salvation plan of God. The whole Godhead. Hear me, somebody. The whole Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit was active on her behalf. Oh, see how important you are? That it takes the entire Godhead to be active on her behalf even before we existed. Help me, Holy Ghost. Help me, Holy Ghost. Help me, Holy Ghost. So I may bring this point home here. God, you see, saints of God, has a plan for, he had a plan before our salvation, should man sin. Jesus, you see, purchased our redemption on the cross, and the Holy Spirit applied that redemption and sanctifies us. You ask me, how you know you are one of the elect? Let me say, all who come are the elect, for no one who comes shall be cast out. If one does not come, they are condemned, and so not one of the elect. For those who do come, their hope or hope is based on the fact that God has already accomplished all that is necessary for our salvation. When George Nixon Briggs was governor of Massachusetts, he had three friends of his who visited the Holy Land. They climbed Golgotha and they cut down a stick to use as a cane and brought it back to present to Governor Briggs. And they said, we wanted you to know that when we stood on Calvary, we thought of you. He assured them of gratitude, and then he added, but I am still more thankful, gentlemen, that there was another one who thought about me on Calvary. He, the governor, rested his hope on the finished work of Jesus Christ. The hands of Christ, saints, are frail. Now, understand that I'm speaking about the human body. And I'll explain it this way. You see, when Jesus was on the cross, it took just a nail and a hammer to pierce his hand. So thus, his hand is frail. But only they reach heaven, those hands, reach heaven at last, whom those frail, broken hands hold fast. You see, we see in verse 3, that the strongest reason for our hope is in the resurrection. Peter calls it a living hope. And I want us to be mindful of this living hope. The cross without a living Savior could not produce a living hope, because there were two other men on the cross, one of which asked for that living hope. One did not ask. The one who asked received the hope. But the other cross did not produce a living hope. Resurrection is not a fanciful fiction or a fantastic fable, but it is the fundamental fact. It is the fundamental fact of the gospel. It is the rock on which our hopes rest. Without it, saints of God, Without it, we would be like the heathen who have no hope. That is what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15. For he said that if Christ is not risen, then our faith is in vain. Paul reminded us that if Christ is not risen, then our faith is in vain. And you and I know today that the tomb is empty. There is no body in that tomb of Jesus Christ. Confucius's bones are still there. All the other people who died, except for a few, Moses, I meant to say, is not there. But Jesus's body is not there. So because Christ was risen from the grave, our faith is not in vain. Allow me to illustrate a hopelessness. A king once planned a terrible torture of his enemy. He had a man arrested and put in a room with 9 windows on one side. Can you visualize a room with 9 windows on one side? Just 9 windows. The other 3 walls were blank, but one side has 9 windows. The man thought that this was not so bad because generally a prison may have 1 window. But when he saw 9, he thought to himself that this is not so bad at all. And so that's where he was getting some happiness from. But at midnight, he was awakened with the blare of a trumpet, and he heard a crashing noise. In the morning, when he woke up, he discovered only 8 windows. Only 8 windows. When the same thing happened the next night and the next day, there were only 7 windows. The terrifying truth struck him. He was in a room with a moving wall operated by clockwork. Each night, it advanced 1/9 of the way to the other wall. On the 9th day at midnight, he would be crushed between those walls. This is a picture of those who have no hope. Paul describes the man who does not believe in the resurrection as being in just such a condition. Peter knew this from his own experience. He made one last desperate attempt. He made one last desperate attempt to rescue Jesus in Gethsemane. But Jesus rebuked him and surrendered. Peter's hope, you know what I'm talking about, when he drew the sword to stop the soldiers. But Jesus rebuked him, picked up the ears, put it back on, and rebuked him. And Jesus surrendered. Peter's hope began to fade rapidly. And soon after, he denied he ever knew Jesus Christ. You remember what Jesus told him about when the cock crew? Peter denied that he ever knew Jesus. After the crucifixion, Peter tried to forget the whole thing and went back to fishing. His hopes had been shattered. But if you go to the book of Acts, you see this same Peter preaching to thousands on the day of Pentecost. You see him boldly going before the Sanhedrin and proclaiming that this same Jesus, whom they crucified, is alive. Every sermon he preached stressed the resurrection, for that was the basis for a lively hope. It was the fact and power of the resurrection that drove the early church to turn the world upside down. We may need to get some of that lively hope so this community
can be turned upside down. It is by faith in the resurrected Lord that we are born again into a lively hope. If we believe in our hearts that God raised Jesus from the dead, that becomes the foundation of being, foundation of being saved and having a lively hope. A lively hope. And verses 5 to 8 establishes the results of our hope. Hope is built on the past, but it looks forward to the future, and it influences the present. That's what hope does. Hope enables us to face the future without fear, but to also experience the blessings of the future in the now and here. Hope reaches out into the age to come and brings back into the present the blessings of eternity. When a person comes home from work and smells the supper cooking, they already begin to experience some of the values of the meal to come. So those whose hope is in Christ, those whose hope is in Christ already experience some of the blessings of the world to come. One of those blessings is the confidence that God will not suffer us to be tempted above what we are able to stand. We rejoice even in trials and praise Him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy. We are kept by the power of God through faith. Kept is a military word that means to be guarded. It is a word used when the governor of Damascus kept the city with a garrison. Faith is not a bugle that calls for the troops to surround the fort. We see the paradox of hope and joy in the midst of heaviness and trials. We will be persecuted, but we are to rejoice and be glad. Or reward in heaven. We will have tribulation, but we are to be of good cheer, for Jesus has overcome the world, and because Jesus overcame the world, we will overcome. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 10, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing. This is not double talk, but is the confidence and courage we can have because our faith and hope is in Christ. We know that suffering. We know that suffering is only for a season, but our salvation is forever. Our trials are only a parenthesis in the flow of life's sentence. Persecution, even unto death, is only a colon for which you pause shortly and then hasten on to continue the eloquent sentence of eternal life. Heaviness of heart will test the health of hope. COVID-19 and the absence from church during that time is only a test of the health of our faith. Persecution has always strengthened the hope of those whose faith is firmly fixed in Jesus Christ. Testing is good for us only if we can understand what it does. It is good for us, for it drives away the superficial. When life is too heavy, it can lead us to put off hope in things. Luther said, affliction was the best book in his library. God help us to be aware of making comfort the goal of our life. A little heaviness may do us good, but it reveals to us what our hope really is. If we turn to Jesus in our trials, we will have hope, and hope can turn our lamentations into laughter and our sorrows into songs. We can have happiness in the midst of heaviness when we have hope of final victory in Christ. The proof of our hope is, do we continue to hope even in the fires of affliction? When Jesus appears, will we stand steadfast and showing the world our confidence in him? Or will we be running like Chicken Little for fear that more of the sky will fall on us? Peter encourages us to consider our trials just a passing thing. That's what Peter shares. Even if the whole sky should fall, it could do no more than purify us if we stand fast. In verse 8, Peter says that our hope in Christ should produce in us such a joy that it cannot be expressed. The deepest and richest experiences of life cannot be expressed. If we attempt it, it comes out superficial. Someone said, true joy is a solid, grave thing which dwells more in the heart than in the face. We might add also, and on the lips. Sometimes silence is the most eloquent way to express our joy. This is especially so in times of trial. To try and express your joy in Christ when you are suffering affliction will almost always sound superficial. Then Peter deals with our future inheritance. The hope for an incorruptible inheritance in heaven is a powerful factor. It is a powerful factor in the Christian life. The Christian who have done most in history have been those who looked beyond the history. Our hope in Christ gives us a wider perspective so that we see things with eternity's values. Eternity's value, in the view of C.S. Lewis, said, it is since Christians have largely ceased to think of the other world that they have become so ineffective in this. Aim at heaven and you will get earth thrown in. Aim at earth and you will get neither. Animals can be content to live only in the present. But for a man to be happy, he must have three things. Then I'm going to close out. Must have three things. Man must have something to do, speaking of women also. Number two, something to love. And number three, something to look forward to. The third is lacking in the hearts of most people outside of Christ. There are men of strong disposition who by grit and sheer willpower make it through the stormy sea of life without loss of hope. But when they reach the harbor of death, their ship sinks anyway, and all was in vain. Proverbs 11, verse 7 says, when the wicked dies, their hope perishes. Workmen discovered a dungeon beneath an old castle in Scotland. And when they entered the dark and damp cell, they saw scratched on the wall, no hope, no hope. This is never the cry of the Christian For his hope is eternal. The Christian's hope is eternal, and it does not fade away even in a dungeon. Ever since Paul and Silas were in the dungeon, there have been songs in the night coming from the tongues of those whose hope is in Christ. Our inheritance is Christ. In Christ is both permanent and pure. The beauty of the earth fades away. The colored leaves that thrill the eyes are soon faded and dry. They are soon only good for the fire. But we look for an inheritance where the beauty and the delight never fades. Nothing can defile. There is no more pain or crying. There is no more death or dying. As for sorrow and for sighing, these shall flee away. In verse 9, Peter tells of the ultimate end of our faith, which is the salvation of our soul. Faith and hope are the two rudders by which God guides our ship of grace, down to the river for his redeeming love, to the sea of salvation. If anyone is not on that ship now, I say to you, make haste. Make haste to get on board, for the tickets are free and all are welcome. The only request the captain of our salvation make is that you confess your sins, accept his death on your behalf, and commit your life to him. In him alone, Jesus alone, is there a hope that can take you through all of life's trials with joy and assurance of eternal life. I say to you, get on board, little children. Get on board. There's plenty of room for you on board. The song says, my hope is built on nothing less but Jesus Christ and righteousness. Saints of God, keep hope alive and receive the living hope. Seek after the living hope. Get on board. Accept Jesus Christ in your life and live for him every day. Father in heaven, we stand before you today, giving thanks for the assurance and promises that you have given us in your Son Jesus, who died on Calvary. Oh God, come into our lives today and give us that confidence we need to stand up for thee. Lord, we look forward to the day when you shall come, when you shall burst the azure sky and put in your appearance, when we shall go home to live with you forever. Keep us, keep our faith and our hope living in thee until you come. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you, saints, for coming to worshiping with us today. God bless you as we now take our leave. Remember, we do not shake hands or hug, and we ask that you just go on and continue to pray for us. Amen.